place for 1990 Nintendo World Championships for the 11 and younger.
Yep.
He wound up winning.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was
Jeff Hansen.
Yeah, that was Jeff.
Mm-hmm.
Who was really awesome. Just a quick. By the way, we have no. None of us have introduced ourselves. By the way, so I. By the way, I'm Gil Ruta. I'm part of SRGE. I'm part of the staff here. So I'm just here to moderate. I'm not actually part of the panel. But Paul is pretty much a new buddy of mine here, Mr. Paul Tesi, who's you're pretty much well known for. And I'm going to say it, pardon the language, but he kicks ass at the Nintendo World Championship, the various World Championship competition games and cards. And you probably do a lot more stuff than that.
Yeah, actually, I do play and compete when they have it on 1990 Nintendo World Championships. 1991 Nintendo Campus Challenge is a very rare occurrence.
Mm-hmm.
You mainly see 1990 and 1992.
Right. Those are the two most available reproduction cartridges
correct.
That you see out there. So
they do have the 1994 Power Fest.
Right.
Which
that's the Ken Griffey Jr. one.
Yes.
SNES. I have that one. So let's go from square one here. So what was the Nintendo World Championships? What were those competitions?
What they did was they went around to various cities around the nation, and each winner from each age group, they had three different age groups, 11 and under, 12 to 17, and 18 and older. And they took each winner from each city and brought them down to California for the big competition.
Now this was mainly the 1991, the big one.
Yes.
A lot of people consider this
is the one that everybody knows,
yeah.
Or most people know.
And it inspired the Wizard.
Yeah.
So, the movie. Has everyone seen The Wizard? I hope so. Okay, good. All right. Yeah. So, yeah. So, it was like 92 cities or something. It turned out to be like 92 or 94 finalists.
It was a huge turnout.
Yeah.
At the big competition.
And it was at Universal Studios, if
yeah.
I remember correctly, was the finals.
Didn't the host help MC Video Power?
Yes. So,
yeah.
that's a neat little trivia fact. Forgot his name, you can probably look him up, but if you've ever seen the TV show Video Power, which was, okay, he knows, so, and the Power Team, yeah.
Video Power or Johnny Arcade.
Yeah, Johnny Arcade, it was basically an Acclaim-sponsored, and yes, the publisher of fairly crappy games, Acclaim actually sponsored a TV show called Video Power, and it started off as just a news magazine type of show. It was like Johnny Arcade with tips, you know, and it was crappy, nobody cared. And then later on, the next season, they turned it into a game show format where they actually brought kids on. I thought it was like playing behind me. I was like, I'm going to sit out there and watch. They actually brought kids live in the studio to play competitions. The competitions were really lame, to be honest. They were like 2 minutes on Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Woohoo! Who got the most points on that? But at the end, they got to do this like the mall run where they got to
see. Yeah, they had a Velcro suit with various game items, game systems, accessories, and lots of
and there was a secret prize.
A secret prize.
And so like, it was like a Neo Geo sometimes.
I believe they told you what the secret prize was.
Yeah, but you had to find it in the mall.
Yes.
Which was like the size of this room, to be honest. It was really tiny.
Yeah.
But then you had to be at the bottom of the slide. Whatever, we're deviating here. Anyways, there were two hosts. So there was Johnny Arcade, who was the main host. Then he had his announcer host. And he had the craziest, like, Jerry Curl mullet. But he always wore like pretty nice suits, and he had the cheesy like game show, you know, radio voice. That guy, that announcer from the Wizard, is the same guy the same guy from the Nintendo World Championships.
Yeah.
So I work for Nintendo, so I say we sometimes. He actually he was the host for the entire tour, all night. Like it was like a 4 month tour. It was crazy, and so he went on to do that show. As a secondary host. Totally deviated. But anyways, Nintendo World Championships, competitions, usually the games consist of...
Three games consist of Super Mario Brothers, Rad Racer, and Tetris. Each game has an objective. Super Mario Brothers has, you have to collect 50 coins. Rad Racer is you complete the course. And Tetris, you just play until you rack up.
Until the time ran out. And so the time limit was... An incredibly dead even
6 minutes 21 seconds.
who picked 6 minutes and 21 seconds? Well, the reasoning behind that was because the cartridge, there was a little bit of loading time between the games, so there was a little bit of transition time. I think they averaged, I think it was like 11 and a half seconds for each, or 10 and a half seconds, some weird number. So that way the player got 6 minutes of game time between these three games.
So what I'm going to do now is we're going to go over some tips on the 1990 Nintendo World Championships. As you see here, I've basically wrote down any tip that I use. And what I also have is a video. In fact, I'll go ahead and show the video right now. This video is a world record run by Frank Westfall. He currently holds, again, world record at 4.5 million. It is huge. I'd like to think I'm somewhere near it, but reality, I'm not. I'm only at 3.1. So
only.
Yeah, only.
Only.
I've only hit 3 million twice. So, okay, well, without further ado, let's go and show off this.
It's a little green out there.
Is it?
Yeah. I don't know if it's translating very well. All right, so you're not gonna hear much audio here.
That's fine. That's fine. I'll
put the mic to the speaker, I don't know.
No.
Come on in, guys.
No.
What's up? All right.
Hey, guys, thanks for coming in. Okay, so. All right, that's better. So what you see here is he goes through the pipe where everybody knows, and he kills himself here. This is the quickest way to achieve 50 coins. Because what you'll do is right here, this 10 coin block, if you do it fast enough, you can get 11 out of it. And so he continually dies in that general area and repeats until he gets 50 coins.
So just to explain what's the format of this is, there's a scoring calculation for each stage, for each of the three games. So Super Mario Brothers, even though you want to collect 50 coins and you get, basically it takes your score that you have at the top, so as you can see here, you got your 50 coins, so whatever your score was, the number of points that you had at that moment is tally to your grand total. But the thing is, you don't want to spend all day on Super Mario Brothers.
No. In fact, something else I wanted to mention, another tip is whatever score you get on Super Mario Brothers affects what blocks you get on Tetris.
I had no idea.
Yeah.
Literally my brain just exploded right now.
Personally, I go for 10,400, just like Frank does, and I get the same blocks every time.
That's gotta be a myth.
No, it's
really?
True. It's Dang. True. I got the same blocks every time.
I'm, by the way, if you guys think this is set up, no. I have no idea that this is going on, so.
Yeah, usually you try to shoot for anywhere between 10,300 to 10,500.
And how does that affect the blocks? Just get better ones?
You get different ones.
Okay.
10,300 has its own set of block orders, as well as 10,400 and 10,500.
Gotcha. Is there anybody who's not familiar with the Nintendo World Championship format, like with the games and stuff? It's okay, you can be honest. You can just throw your hand up. Okay, you can nod your head. Okay. So anyways, just to kind of go back, it's three games, 6 minutes and 21 seconds to go through them all. And we just went through Super Mario Bros. This is a world record run being run.
Yes, this is, again, this is Frank Westfall. He is the current world record holder for the Nintendo World Championships 1990 at 4.5 million.
Yeah, which is a lot of points. So Super Mario Bros. Got 10,000 or whatever. That's really, not worrisome. It's what you want to do is, ultimately, you want to get to Tetris. You want to get rid of, get that time out of the way. Save as much of it as possible, just get these games out of the way. So he's doing the one lap, we're finishing the course here after he got his 50
points. I want to stop you right there.
Yeah.
Now, the reason he crashed and he lands
he
at the finish line is because it gets to Tetris faster. Because if you go through that finish line, you're going to slow down and that's gonna lose you 5 seconds.
So if you want to get to work quicker,
oh,
go through the exit. Just go through
happened?
The. Oh, what'd you do?
I didn't do anything. It did it by itself.
You did. What's happening?
Sorry for the breath. This is how, like, we plug it in and it just kind of came out like this.
That's okay. With Rad Racer, most of you guys played Rad Racer NES?
You played it, yeah.
So, you know, you hold the up button, you get top speed of 255 miles per hour?
Okay. Turbo power.
So, you hold the up button and you get a top speed of 255 miles an hour. If you maintain that speed, well, first I should say at the countdown, right before you start going, hold your accelerator, hold up, and just hold it there until you get 255. As long as you maintain the 255, the cars will be in the same spot every time, and they will do the same thing. They'll move in the same spots
never,
every time.
I never knew that.
That's great. Okay.
Yeah.
Like, I play this, and as a plebeian, I play and I score, what, like 800,000? And I drop the controller, and I'm like, yeah. I'm
so
amazing.
Yeah, as you see right here, tip number two, hold up on the D-pad and hold A. All the AI cars will be in the same spots and do the same thing. And as you saw, crash your car at the, when you see that final car coming, the trees come in sets of threes. So,
one, two, three.
And when you see that car getting close to you, count one, two, and you crash on the third tree. And you stop right at the finish line, and it gets you right to Tetris.
Don't do that during your commute. Just, don't. Yeah. Not a good idea. You will not get a high score that way.
So, Tetris is pretty self-explanatory. Really, the best way to do it is keep an open space to either side, the left or right. I prefer the right. And so that way, drop lines and just get constant Tetrises. Because Tetrises is what's going to get you the scores.
Yep.
The weirdest thing about what they did with this Tetris is, like the original Tetris, 10 lines you move to the next level. That's not the case in this.
Right.
So it just goes by a level multiplier.
Yep.
So level zero, it's a, you know.
I knew that.
One. Level one is one. Level two times two, and so on and
right.
So forth. So really, it's just get Tetrises, get Tetrises, get
and,
Tetrises.
And what's and the multiplier on that? And is it 100? No, it's
25.
So it takes so to explain your Super Mario score, you get 10,000. That's your score on Rad Racer. I think it multiplies that by five. I think
it's one. Mario Brothers is one. Rad Racer's is 10.
10.
Tetris is 25.
25. So it's by 10. So if you got like 6,000 on Rad Racer, then you got
60,000.
So. Those scores are minuscule compared to when you get to Tetris, it's multiplied by 25. And so it's monstrous. Another example, and not to get too far ahead, is like if you, I think it was it the 94 final Power Fest cart? This is the one you're doing Ken Griffey Jr.?
Yes, yeah.
Basically they ignored the first two games. You go through those and you get 1,000,000 points for every home run in the home run derby of Ken Griffey Jr. 1,000,000. Like the total score you'd have is like, you know, up to that point was like a few 10,000 or something like that.
To be honest, I have never played the 1994 Power Fest, but I am picking it up this weekend.
Oh, there you go.
So
there you go.
What they did was they actually did two different kinds of 94 Power Fests. What they did was they made one where they had a times million multiplier for Ken Griffey.
Right, for the finals.
Yeah, and then they did a times 10,000.
Right, which is much more balanced.
Yeah.
All things considered. So basically, if you made it to the finals, and then also there was the format where they split everyone up into teams all of a sudden. They put you on teams, like baseball teams. It was so stupid. Anyways, ignore that part. But for the regular competition, though, it was 10,000 points per home run, which was nice and balanced. So you would probably maybe get some points in, what was it? What were the other two games?
The first game was Super Mario All-Stars.
All-Stars. Was it Pilot Wings?
No, that's 92.
That's 92.
Yeah.
I get mixed up.
No, it's Super Mario Kart.
Oh, it's Kart. That's right.
Yeah, Super Mario.
And it was weird. It was not your score was your time. It was your time range. That's right.
Yeah, it's
you got like 70,000 points or something if you finish like in a certain time range. It was really bizarre. The way
actually,
they set
I
it
think
up.
It, I think they give you a certain amount of points for how you finish the laps.
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah. I'll know more about that later.
The point was, like, if you were in the finals, if you made it to the finals and you were doing the home run, you made it to, all you did was get the home run derby. That's all. It was a million points and it just, you know, that made the contest.
Yeah. So, any questions on the 1990 Nintendo World Championships? Any questions that you guys might have?
You can, how can one be able to play the Nintendo
I have
card?
A 1990 Nintendo World Championships right here. Once we get done with, well, I'm gonna work on the 1992 Campus Challenge.
Okay.
Once we get done with that, we'll have whoever wants to come up, you have the option to play either 1990 or 1992.
You need to get at least 3 million points.
No, no.
3 million.
No, I won't ask that of you. That's way too hard. Okay, so 1992 Super Nintendo Campus Challenge. Again, competition winner, Jeff Hansen, who was one of the winners of 1990 Nintendo World Championships. World record holder, me. I actually, that was a great birthday present because they actually finalized and authenticated that score on my birthday in July.
Dude, that's awesome. You just get drunk on my birthday.
That was a very nice birthday present in the morning. So, all right, so 1992 Super Nintendo Campus Challenge consists of Super Mario World, F-Zero, and Pilot Wings. Super Mario World, same concept as Super Mario Brothers, collect 50 coins. F-Zero, again, same concept as Rad Racer.
With like two laps.
Yep, complete two laps.
Beat City, so mm-hmm. the first course.
Yep, and Pilot Wings, just rack up a score, and it's for parachuting and high diving.
That's right. Got to hit the bullseye. And there's also a side target that you can go for, which was a popular tactic, really. You wanted to go for that to get the high score.
Actually, are you talking like the moving platforms?
Yeah.
Nah, I never go for those.
Really?
Never.
I don't know. I watch
Hansen's
videos.
Because the chances of landing on those are slim to none.
Sick. Okay, I don't want to get ahead of myself in the story, so go ahead.
Yeah, you're
he's
most,
really good at that, though.
You're most likely to fall in the water than land on
those.
Because it's moving, it slips from under you. You can land on it and be like, hey, great, next thing you know, sploosh.
That's not very fair.
I've had that happen to me a lot. It's not fun. Okay, so, 19, there we go. So this is a video that I made. This is my world record run. Because it's going to Twin Galaxies, which is basically the Guinness Book of World Records website for video games, you know, I have to show them everything in detail that I'm playing on an authentic console. I am showing them the cart, the dip switches for the that is set for the amount of time, and that I'm playing on a legitimate controller. So, and so, as you, it's kind of blurry, and I apologize. There we go. Okay, so there have been rumors that once you start, you have the option of choosing the left level or the right level. There have been rumors saying that going to the left level, getting through that, and going up to the yellow switch palace is the fastest way. That is false. That is not true. Some guy...
I just lost a bet.
No. Some guy told me last year that was the fastest way until I sat down and I showed him. So, the trick to this is you see the berries? Yoshi will pop up right here. Hop on Yoshi, and if you get the berries, when you come across the berries and press and double tap the Y button, instead of one coin, it'll count for two coins. So you just keep doing that. You just go, and then each enemy that you swallow is also one coin. Just keep double tapping, and then ta-da.
And the math, the scoring on this is pretty simple.
Right here. Multiplier for Mario World times 1, F-Zero times 100, Pilot Wings times, I think it said 10,000.
you can tell us at Nintendo we really, really came up with a very balanced mathematical way of scoring these competitions.
With F-Zero, I like to do...
Do you crash?
No.
Absolutely kidding.
Thank God, no.
Yeah.
what I like to do is you'll have a 3-beep countdown before you start, and after the second beep is when I press down on the accelerator. So that way it kind of it gives you a little bit smoother
boost,
start.
Yeah.
Not really a boost, it's just a smoother start.
Yeah.
After one lap you obtain a boost. I personally don't use the boost until the final turn of this course, because the final turn is so sharp that when you make that turn without the boost, you drop speed. So when you use the boost, you maintain that speed throughout the entire turn, and then once that's done, you're back to normal speed.
I see that.
All right. And I choose the Blue Falcon just because you just keep pressing A, you don't have to press anything else. You know, some people go for the pink car or the green
car.
Right,
Samurai Goro.
Yeah.
You just want to save time. Every second counts.
Yeah. So I just use Blue Falcon regardless. Okay, so Pilot Wings. This is probably the hardest game to figure out. This did actually take me a long time to actually learn, because I didn't really play Pilot Wings by itself, so I kind of learned on this. Quickest way to get to your targets is to adjust your parachuter from a horizontal position to a vertical position, and you have rings that you go through in each of the parachuting stages. Now, the rings will be in the same spots all the time. So anytime that you wanted to practice on this game, they're gonna be there. No, there'll be no changes or anything like that. The high diving with the penguin suit, I don't know why they gave him a penguin suit. I think it's kinda cool, but really it's just trying adjust your diving position to the highest score. So like on this level, you'll see that the rings, instead of just one after another, they're kind of scattered. So again, you'd have to adjust your turn to adjust, and if you have to adjust between bringing yourself up from a horizontal to a vertical or vice versa, you know, do so. I apologize about the picture. On the third and fourth parachuting stage, which we'll be coming up to on the third parachuting stage, what it'll show is, it'll say, I believe northeast and some number, like 2 ms. Basically, it's a wind change. So when you deploy your chute, since it says northwest, when you deploy your chute, it's going to push you northwest. So when you see the target right now, it's over on the left.
And these are tough targets to hit now, once you get to this part of the game.
Yeah, when you get wind changes, the landing is tougher. So.
And how easy do you find it to, like these penguin diving segments? Some people find them incredibly difficult, but I've seen like top level play players, they seem to just kind of like, they seem to just know the pattern, you know,
it's,
where to go.
Once you practice it enough, it gets easier.
Mm-hmm.
Like one of them, I turn maybe three notches, and like three button presses, and then another three button presses to go to a...
So you have the math, in your head, basically.
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah, it's like a muscle memory.
Yeah.
Okay.
And same thing with that last penguin where it was that 50 in the bullseye. I guess I should say this level has an east wind change, so... By the way, I barely got that 70.
That's a tiny target, you know?
Yeah. I barely got that 70.
That is tiny.
So... 6 minutes, 21 seconds is up. And there's my final score.
Six. Wow, 6.1 million, guys. Look at that. And that's the current world record. When did you accomplish this?
I did this without video recording. I want to say around the end of June, beginning of July.
Oh, so not too long ago.
No.
Oh, wow. Okay.
No, yeah.
So it's still recent.
Yeah. So then I said, okay, well, if I can do this now, why can't I do it again? So I literally set up my phone on a because yeah.
What you got.
Yeah. So
that's awesome.
So I set up my phone, set it as a camera record and put it towards my TV and just said, okay, let's try this again. And I won't lie, it took me a couple tries.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it took me a couple tries.
It's only taken me 20 just to get maybe a million. But
once I got it, you know, I was just like, I kind of don't have to play this anymore.
There you go. Once you do it, until somebody beats it, and then you're like, So somebody beats the world.
I would love to see that, you know, and I would welcome that.
Yeah.
You know, if they can find another way to top that, I would love to see it. But so, anybody have any questions on 1992? Pretty cut and dry. Yeah.
These are pretty advanced techniques for you guys. Just to give a little history on this, though. Obviously it was in 1992, but the big thing was we're talking about Jeff Hansen, who was the U.S. champion. He actually they actually competed at the Consumer Electronics Show against the Japanese champion.
Yeah, they actually I don't remember. Did they send him to Japan?
Well, there was a Japanese competition on a kid's show.
Right.
And then they went head to head, and he still won. So the actual world championship crowning, though, was, I believe, at CES. So, but it could have been the show. But it was still...
Hello, welcome. You're kind of in the middle, but it's all good.
It was a big deal, though, at least in Japan. They actually, like, they kind of put a lot of, a bit of production into it. The video is actually available on YouTube, so if you want to look that up, let's see, like, Jeff Hansen. It's a three-part video, so it's a lot to watch. And it's actually shot by someone who's in the audience. I want to say it's, like, one of his family members.
Huh.
They're, like, literally in the front row. Yeah, they're literally in the front row, and it's fascinating. So you'll probably get a kick out of that. But if you guys want a little bit more history...
I would love to see what score he got.
I don't remember.
4 million.
But
I guess.
But I'm being tweeted at right now. Somehow. All right. Anyways.
So those are kind of the tips and tricks on how to better your scores on both the 1990 and 1992 competition cards. Again, there are more out there, like 1991, they have that downstairs for the prelims for Armageddon. I will say it is much tougher than these two.
Yep.
Because Dr. Mario. Because
Dr. Mario the randomness.
Dr. Mario.
Yeah, which kind of fast forwards to this year's 2015 Nintendo World Championships that we held.
Okay, most of you guys know that they brought back the Nintendo World Championships, and
it was awesome.
Yeah.
Well. Yeah.
Oh, you sound like you have an axe grinding here. Let's let it out. No. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Okay.
We got 10.
All right. To be fair. I actually did go to Best Buy to try and qualify for this year's Nintendo World Championships. I did not qualify. In fact, I did pretty bad. And I wish I knew what I know now back then.
Sure.
Because back then I was lucky enough to hit maybe 1.8 million
mm-hmm.
Compared to a lot of the other bigger players. That's not much at all.
Yeah.
Now I'm hitting 2-3 million, 4 millions more often, and
creeping up.
I just hit 5.5 million just recently.
Ooh.
So I
keep in touch with a lot of the guys who were in the competition, who like the big qualifiers, and guys like Packy and PSP. You know, they're all buddies.
Oh yeah, Chris. I talk to Chris all the time.
And so they, they're still chasing. There are online leaderboards, so you can still play NES Remix. and you can play the Nintendo World Championship format. It's a weird format. It's Super Mario Brothers.
Super Mario Brothers.
Yeah.
Super Mario Brothers 3. And Dr. Mario.
And then Dr. Mario. So it's all Mario themed. Anyways, so there's online leaderboards and people are still chasing them. You know, like they want to be the best in the world, get the high score, and then post it online. So.
Something else I wanted to mention. Some of these competition cards have not just, there's a couple ways to achieve high scores. Like, for instance, not so much on these ones, but definitely 1991. As you know, BSG, he just broke the world record.
Just last week. That's right.
So he's sitting at like 11.7 million. I will never touch that. So my method to 1991 is I stay on Mario 3 and just spam for points and just kind of time it out.
Right.
Kind of get a feel for, you know, when you should stop and go ahead and collect the coins.
And the three games in that card are
Super Mario 3, Pinball. Yeah.
And that one, oh yeah, because the really tough part is the skill shot. Yeah, the skill shot, because it almost feels random. Like it, at least according to you know, to the logic of like BSG, so what you have to do is you have to hit a skill shot. You basically have to score 100,000 points in Pinbot to move on to Dr. Mario. So, but to get it, you get one skill shot. So it's 100,000 for the skill shot. So second hole. To get to be on world record pace, you have to hit the skill shot on the first try. Mm-hmm. If you don't, it's reset.
Yes, you may as well.
Yeah. So.
But anyway.
Plus the three games.
So yeah. So there are other ways to get decently high scores on some of these competition cards. There's not just one way. Which is nice.
Yeah.
I like that. On the NWC remix, the Mario 3, instead of times 10, like what they have it on 91,
right.
They have it at times 1.
Yeah.
I'm so mad about that.
I mean, everyone's good at certain parts of, they're good at different games or different, parts of the game. And so, but ultimately, in the end, I'm slightly of a competitive gamer myself. Especially when it comes to high scores, you just have to adapt. And I hate to say it that way, not to give that as advice, but to any gamer who wants to achieve high scores, especially in these games, it's not necessarily learn from everyone else, it's just adapt. Just figure it out, because...
Actually, I would say learn from whoever has the highest scores. Kind of mimic what they do, and try and go from there.
Right.
Because with 1990, with Frank's Tetris block placements, I start the same way, and then after a while, after it starts to stack up, I kind of start doing my own thing. Start trying to drop Tetrises as much as possible. But
I guess the moral story is don't bitch about it. Like, it's just it's like, oh man, I wish they'd change this. Shut up. Just play it. Figure it out. You'll do it because everyone else is going to be doing it. Someone else is going to be the best, and you're not if you're just going to push it aside and blaming the rule sets or whatever. So it is what it is.
I'll admit when I had the toughest time with Dr. Mario.
Oh yeah.
I had the toughest time, and some of my I got some friends that are here in the audience. They will say the same thing that I said. You know what? Screw this.
Has everyone played Dr. Mario? Everyone knows what's up with how that game works. That the fields are completely random. It's not like Tetris where even if you get random blocks and you get a poor set of blocks, you can still do something with it. But in Dr. Mario, you are at the mercy of where the viruses are placed on the field. And if you have bad placement, you're not going to get the points that you want. So a lot of players who do the Nintendo World Championship remix, they just, if they see a bad placement, they're like, oh, I'll just start over. But one of the biggest tips from my buddy was like, just play it. Even if you have the worst setup on Dr. Mario, play it, clear it quick, and then maybe you'll get an amazing setup the next time around. And
biggest thing is learn to multi-stack.
Yeah.
That's what's going to get you the points, okay. And I had to learn that the hard way.
Oh, it's so hard to do.
It is ridiculously hard, but again, just like you said, adapt.
Yeah.
You'll eventually get it. Just practice. I mean, I don't know how many hours I spent on a Dr. Mario arcade machine. I've spent countless hours just casual playing and just figuring things out, and that has actually helped. So it definitely helps to practice and adapt.
Are there any questions from you guys? Any rants, raves, comments, complaints? I feel like just the two of us are kind of going like,
burr. In 1992, when did that mod become available? That was pretty recent that it was actually dumped onto a repro cart, right? That one was, with the 90, those carts went out for a while, but people got them as prior.
Right, those were given away, yeah, so there was like 110.
The campus, like, there was only a handful, there's like one or two.
Yeah, because they were not distributed.
Right, they were meant to be destroyed, so isn't that pretty recent?
So, the ROM has actually been around for at least a couple of years, at least a few years.
Right. So I think I know the story behind this, though.
You do?
I think I do. So, well, first of all, just a touch. So the question was, you know, how available is the ROM, the 92 ROM? Correct.
Well, like, just when did that actually get?
When did it actually? So I don't know the details of the story. But on that ROM specifically, so 1990 was distributed as a prize, so it's, you know, easy to ROM dump. You can find that everywhere. But with 92, the ROMs, basically, there were only competition carts. There were no prize carts, so they had to be destroyed. They were basically, you know, Nintendo said, ship them back to us, and we have to destroy them. So apparently, two got out, somehow survived, and
yep.
I would not be surprised if they were, you know, fellow old employees, you know, from back in the day. You know, they survived, and
I do know one got passed around a couple times.
Right, and then there was one that was like basically it was just like a myth, you know, the second one that was a myth, and it turned up all of a sudden on a very long series of logs from a gentleman who somehow just got a random email from somebody. Or from a friend of his who was like also a collector, and he said, I have a line on a 92 card. Are you interested? And he's like, yeah, and it's a long story, I'm not gonna go through it. You can probably find the blog online. But apparently the two guys, it was the craziest story how they tried to make the deal, but it came down to like in a hotel in the middle of nowhere, like literally a motel room. It was like a scene out of a bad 70s, you know, action film. And then the only thing missing was like the cops bursting through the windows and stuff. This, because the guy was totally sketched, brought a friend with him, and was just like, was watching him like every step away, and they counted the money like in a briefcase, like no joke. It was like a secret agent thing. When they made the exchange, it was that guy's ROM that got dumped at some point. I don't know how long it took, you know, but it was like, I think that exchange happened like maybe 4 to 5 years ago. I want to say maybe even further. But then it took a while, and then he got approached and was like, hey, you know, we'd like to dump it. And I think he went through a super, very similar, you know, like he was super protective because it cost him tens of thousands of dollars, I'm sure.
Right, if you mess it up,
then that's it.
Right, you fry the board too.
It's done.
Yeah,
it's useless.
And that was probably the big reason why it took so long from the exchange when he got a hold of it. It was just like, you know, I'm really protective of this, I don't want to damage it. But there's video of them in the hotel room testing it right there, and they show it, and then they like shake hands, and then they, you know.
It's funny, the have you seen what the cart looks like? It doesn't look like your typical Super Nintendo card. It's
almost the size of the console itself. Yeah. Yeah. It was a large, very large board. I wouldn't be surprised if I know like one or two of the guys who actually engineered the board themselves, you know, who still work at Nintendo today. But yeah, it almost looks like a small arcade board.
It looks like a Nintendo game, like a 32X.
Yeah, I was just gonna say it looks like a bigger 32X.
Yeah, yeah.
That's kind of what it looks like.
It's huge, and then there's not even a top to it, so it just has a bottom half shell.
Yeah.
And I honestly don't recognize the shell from anything. The only thing I can think of maybe is maybe Super Famicom, but they're the same shape. So like, anyways. So what's next?
Well, I'd like to get people to come play these games.
Oh snap.
I just don't know how we're gonna hook up the TV to the console.
To the console?
Yeah. I don't see any AV ports.
So are there any of the other competitions that you wanted to like touch base on? Like maybe like 94, or have you just not played those yet?
I haven't played 94.
Is there a world record? Now, are there any world records you want to chase? Like, let's go off the topic of the world championship cards. How about the Star Fox championship card? How about the Donkey Kong, you know, blockbuster tournament?
I haven't played in any of those either.
Would you want to?
Yes. And I know a couple other people that would like to try those too.
Cool.
I know another friend of mine who would love to get his hands on the Star Fox competition weekend.
Yeah.
In fact, it's funny, another buddy of mine, he's actually in the audience. So how was 94 Power Fest?
It was fun.
Out in Port Angeles.
I won a hat. and a poster.
Was it at least like a 90s trucker hat?
No, it wasn't a trucker hat. It was just like a black hat with an embroidered Power Fest logo. And I got that in a poster. It was one of those like stare at it 3D posters, and apparently
stereogram.
Yeah.
I remember that poster.
It's a scooter, you dumbass.
Apparently it had Samus, but my eyes are crap.
Honestly, I didn't see Samus. I couldn't see anything out of it.
I don't know what you guys are talking about, but okay. Sounds cool. I'll have to look into that. Before we carry on, so if any of you guys want to like get into this, so he's got two of the boxes here. These are from RetroZone. So these are the reproduction cartridges we've been talking about that he's got plugged in, and we're gonna somehow magically try to get to work on the TV. If not, if you guys want to come down to my booth, I'm doing the streaming booth down there, so you've probably seen it at some point. Maybe we'll pop those in, and maybe Paul can, you know, walk you through it and play some games, have some fun. Anyways, these are you can get these off of RetroZone. The website is retrousb.com.
I would like to add, right now, they just made available 1990 and 1991. They don't have any 92 or 94 Power Fest at the moment. Part of me doesn't see them doing it again.
Well, I was going to touch on that. So the guy who runs the website, literally he does runs of these cards when he feels like just whenever. So I mean, he says there's a reason behind it. I don't think there really is. It's like, oh, people have been asking for 94. Okay, I guess I'll do 20. And then so,
oh, okay, I'll get on that.
They'll show up in the store
like years later.
Yeah, realistically, like several months later, they'll show up. If they go up though, and like if you guys are on any of the collector forums or you know Facebook groups or anything, put an ear to the ground on those.
Nintendo Age would be a
Nintendo Age is a great spot.
Yeah,
you'll get word of these. They'll come out. They range anywhere from what like $75 to $125, I think.
Yeah, I think
pretty high. A bit high for my taste.
Honestly, I paid more for those.
Okay. I mean, regardless, however you get them. Also, you might get a chance to get in some special editions at shows. Like 4 years ago, Portland Retro. I mentioned this to you. Earlier this morning, I have the Portland version, which is it's a green cartridge. He's got like the you know the purple, blue, the kind of cobalt purple, and if that's even a color. But it's they did a special green edition. There's only like 42 cards, and I actually got those signed by my buddies Thor and Robin Mahara. So Thor Ackerman being the world champion, he was the 13-17 champion.
What they actually did was at with the three winners at the California event, they put those three in a competition against each other to see
grand
who claimed the grand champion, and it wound up being Thor Ireland.
Yeah. So that was really cool. We also had Thor out at down in LA back in June for the 2015 World Championships. He was in the front row. Kick out of
Jeff Hansen.
Jeff was there.
Yeah,
there was quite a few of those guys actually. We brought them all out there, so it was really cool. But those two guys specifically.
Yeah. Thor will be in Portland next month.
Yes. So that was,
I am actually looking forward to that because I've never
head to head. Head to head.
Head to head.
Head to head on stream.
Oh, God. On stream.
On stream.
You gonna be there?
I'll be there. I don't know if I can bring my strap with it. We'll try and make something.
All right.
So you got witnesses. All right.
Me versus Thor Ackerland.
All right. Give it up for Paul, guys.
Yeah.
Let's see this. Him versus Thor. One on one. Best of five. I don't know. Oh, is it working? What do we got?
We got him, but it's in black and white.
Wow.
Just because
super retro mode. It's like,
all right, so who wants to play?
Anybody want to give it a try? There, look at that bull.
Can we give a shot, bro?
And he's got a tie, so you know he's serious. So while he gets set up, we have a ton of time, but you know we may not take it all up, so we'll have him play. I'll touch a little bit on my personal experience on the Nintendo World Championship from way back in the day. So, you know, and this is totally your panel, I'm going to hijack it just because I feel like it.
No, that's cool.
So,
I'm actually grateful that that you're here because you were able to share a lot of information that even I didn't know.
Just to kind of touch on our relationship, this is the first time we met today. Actually, he wandered to my booth. He was like, yeah, we'll do a competition. And then he was like, yeah, I got a panel later today. I was like, oh, I'm moderating your panel. And so I was like, oh, you're Paul Tesi. And so I was like, oh, I know all about your exploits. And you win like every gaming competition locally, you know, like whenever these, you know, world
championships. Yeah, usually. I actually.
That's awesome, though.
Yeah, the last time they had the 1990 competition was at SakuraCon earlier this year, and yeah, I hit 3 million. Second place was like 1.9.
And you're entered in Arcade Armageddon tonight?
Haven't done my preliminary run yet, but yes,
yeah, I will do it today. And just to let you know, I will be doing the play-by-play for tonight's Arcade Armageddon.
Sweet! I know our MC now.
I know who's going to harass you now. So.
Oh, excellent.
It's going to be an awesome competition run by Icarus Kid and all those guys. They do a great job. And so please stay tonight. Great show. One particular one, who was it? Red? Somebody, one of the acts. They're giving away CDs. Of a brand new album with 13 tracks, and it's actually, I don't even have mine. Do you have your, well, you guys have your badges. It's in an original floppy sleeve, like the casing of the sleeve. Oh, and so you open it, and yeah, you go through the paper inserts that it's covered in, and then once you open it, you open up the sleeve, it slides out, and the actual CD is in there. Only the first 100 get those. So Red Martian.
There we go. All
yeah, right. Red Martian. They're an amazing, amazing group, and so stick around to see them there tonight.
Yeah. So Arcade Armageddon this year, again preliminary is 1991 Nintendo Campus Challenge. The announced games are Off Road, Mortal Kombat 2, and
we're playing some of that stream earlier.
Balloon Fight.
Yes. A little yeah. Homage to Mr. Iwata.
Yes.
Passing. So
R.I.P.
Good man. Yeah. I've met him several times, and he was just a real treat, very super humble. I could not meet a more humble man, and trust me, I work for a Japanese company, and there's a lot of humble folks, you know, from it in CL, but none more than Mr. Wada. He appreciated everything everyone did at both, you know, here at Nintendo America and everywhere else, and to the fans. So for anyone,
it was really hard when, you know, hearing about his passing, even though a lot of us, you know, we've never met the guy, but it's the fact that he made our childhoods.
Touched a lot of hearts.
Yeah.
So it
was a big hit for all gamers.
Yeah. For any of you guys who posted anything like on Twitter or anything, you know, kind of said a thank you or whatever, you know, or you know, an RIP, thank you for being fans. You know, from my personal standpoint, it's been my dream come true to work for the company, and I live for the fans. I live for you guys. I live for, you know, if you have any kids who love Nintendo, if you have any friends who love Nintendo, either young or old, it's Mr. Iwata's passion for gaming that lives through all of us, and so we do the best we can. Speaking of Nintendo,
get him on an NES, get him on a Super NES. Seriously, just
get him on a Campus Challenge 92 cartridge.
No, let's not go that far. Get him on the starting games, you know, Super Mario Brothers, Super Mario World, you know, a lot of the beginning classics. Yeah. Get him started on those and let, you know, have them
have an appreciation for, you know, the games that we had, and then, you know, they'll grow to love games even more. That's my opinion.
Speaking of the championships and the challenges and the Power Fest, did you attend any of those? Were you?
I have not.
Okay.
I have never attended. Actually, this year's qualifying at Best Buy in Tacoma was the first time I've ever done it.
Okay, any Nintendo competition?
Yeah.
Nice competition?
Otherwise, it's just been local competitions, like
right.
Here at
stuff like
here at SRGE. I've done Arcade Armageddon for the last 2 years. I finalist both years. Was the winner in 2013.
Yep.
And second place last year because that guy over there. But you know that's totally cool. I'm actually very happy that he did.
Okay.
So. But yeah, this year is, you know, who knows?
Yeah.
Anybody
else, like, entered the comp? Like, anybody remember the original competitions? Like, anybody old enough? Am I aging? Besides this guy.
Besides the guy that went to 94.
You went to 94? See, I didn't go to 94.
I did another one, too. They did some, like, Q13 Kids Fest thing in the Kingdom 1 year. I can't remember which competition card it was. I know it had the parachute jump from Pilot Wings.
Oh, it must have been 92.
And I won.
But that was a campus challenge. They definitely didn't do it.
So it must have been like a small sponsored thing.
I won a Star Fox patch.
I have that patch. I have that same patch. It's it's a black patch with space and stuff, and then it has the Star Fox. I feel old now. I just aged like 30 years. So I attended the original Nintendo World Championships in 1990, and the fest. How'd you do?
2 or 76,000.
Oh, snap.
276,000.
You've lost.
Yeah, pretty much.
He's breathing down your neck.
Good run, dude.
We have time for one other person to make a run.
Anybody want to try and beat that? I'll give you a prize in my booth if you can beat it. There it goes. All right. Now people line up. How about this? How about this? We'll do this. We'll have one more person play, or do you not? It's up to you.
Switch to campus challenge.
Okay, somebody go do that.
Who wants to try a campus challenge?
Okay. Who's not like pro elite at this stuff, okay? What?
Yeah.
Sitting down. Okay. Alright, well I know where to look out for you. So how about this? Let's do this. We'll do a little Paul challenge here. So in the streaming booth, SRGE stream booth, which is actually my independent stream, which I literally just started like a month or two ago. But come on down. We'll pop on some of these carts, and we'll take X number of challengers, and we'll stream it. And I'll give away goodies to anyone who participates, and then I'll give away, you know, something cool to the winner or second place, whatever. All right? So come on down, spread the word, tell your friends, and we'll do some Power Fest and Canvas Challenge.
I won't have Power Fest yet.
You don't have Power Fest? I have a Power Fest cart.
On you?
With me down there.
Really?
Yep. Not a legit one, don't.
That's fine.
No, I have a rebrand. Yeah.
I would love to play that.
Okay.
That and Battletoads.
That and Battletoads, yeah, that's right. We were talking about Battletoads earlier, doing some Contra Hardcore for a challenge. So just to touch on my experience though, I was young, I was pretty young, but it was in the Old Kingdom here in Seattle, and it was huge. And I remember the way it was set up was, basically it was trucks. They had like the semi-cap, you know, like trailers. And then they would open up, and then they would literally the trailers would transform, and they would become the long stations. And so it was like probably,
that's right. Didn't they do that?
They did that for
campus
like
challenges?
They did that for campus challenges later on too.
Yeah,
but it was a little different. They were totally different. They were like smaller trailer type things. They used the full semi truck size ones though for campus.
Okay.
And so I was there, and I wanted to qualified. I got a qualifying score. I think it was. Can't remember what the score was. I think you had to get like 800,000 or a million or something like that. They kept somebody said they changed it like during the weekend.
So anyways, I qualified my age group. And then so it took me to the Sunday, no, I had to do the Saturday knockout round. And so, and then that did it, and then if you won that, you went to the Sunday finals, basically. It was your, the city finals. And I won and made it to that. So my mom only wanted me to bring it to Saturday, because she we were poor. And she was like, oh. And then they were like, yeah, you have to buy a ticket. And she's like, all right, I'll bring you back, because I love you. And so she brought me back, and I competed, and I finished last. But, yeah, no, I got trashed, because it wasn't that good of a score. It's probably the worst qualifying score out of all. But I had a blast. I don't remember much else, like, other than playing that game. I played Double Dragon for Game Boy. Like, the Game Boy had just come out. Like, it was, or I don't even think it was out, or something like that. They just had a slew of Game Boy games. I played Super Spike V-Ball. And they played that.
Oh, yeah.
We should get some foreplay down there. Super Hood. I have memories of all those great games, and then seeing Super Mario Bros. 3 for the first time because they did trailers for Wizard, and they kind of snuck that in there for Power Fest attendees only. So I got my shirt, I got all my stuff, some of my stuff. I have my mother's shirt though. It was like some giant extra large shirt. Just, you know, she wasn't small, but I still have that, and that's actually hanging in my arcade room, in my game room as like one of my treasures. It's one of my favorite memories. So, as a gamer, this guy rocking in here.
No, I'm actually having a pretty terrible run.
I'm terrible.
Oh, so you should admit it.
12 minutes. Are there any?
Sorry, I can give this guy garbage. I've known him for 20 years.
Competitive gamers.
Oh, you think that's bad? You should see us on Tetris Attack.
Okay, well, we can talk about, like, Tetris Attack, or Panel of Pawn, as we should say, at Nintendo.
I did see that.
That is a fiercely played game on campus.
Yeah.
So, are there any questions for Paul? I mean, this guy has set world records. He wins competitions left and right. It's got to...
Okay. Oh, boy.
What's the next record you think you're going to break, or looking to break?
Right now, I am... I'm in the midst of getting a matching world record for TNC Surf Designs for Wooden Water Age, just a max out score.
All right, can I stop you for a second?
Yes.
Who the hell thinks about setting a world record on TNC Surf Design?
Hey, that can't be
off. Especially the surfing portion.
Stop it. Don't try. Okay.
Well, really, that's all you do is just spam on surfing. That's it.
I'm just like, who picks that game?
Actually, there's quite a few. There's quite a few scores on.
From a realistic standpoint, I know a lot of games. There's a lot of, I mean, almost every game.
Hold on, I'm not done yet.
All right.
So I also have another one that's currently trying to be authenticated for Puss in Boots: Perilous Great Adventure. Believe it or not.
Okay.
So is TNC weird now?
No, yes. TNC's still weird to me.
Okay. My other one is Bucky O'Hare.
Oh, yes. That's a good game.
Yes, I'm...
I still said Bucky.
Just Bucky O'Hare.
Thank you. All right, see? All right, we got it. See, someone as old or enjoys the cartoons.
Oh, yeah, I watched it.
Just like, you know, TNC Surf Design, like, that's like the equivalent of, like, someone saying, hey, I want to get a world record on tennis. Like, he's probably like, all right, I'll jot that right down to the day.
No.
Boop. Okay.
You done yet?
No.
Why not?
I don't know.
We're waiting for you, pal.
Anyone out there, is anybody like particularly good at a competition cart or just competitively on a specific game that you enjoy? Or that you're trying for? No? I'll jump in. I'm a Donkey Kong player, so I have no
killer junior
arcade original. So I have a high of 696k, no kill screen yet. I've come close. I think level 19 or 18. I can't remember. So still nothing on cam. So nothing to record until I get a kill screen. I don't care.
I'll be honest. I'm god awful at Donkey Kong. In fact, I'm god awful at all Donkey Kong games.
It's just like any other competitive game. It's you love it.
Jump over the barrels.
You love it until you want to kill it. It's brutal. He's dead.
How'd you do?
2,638,106.
Color me impressed, dude.
Not bad.
Nice.
All
right. I'll give that.
Not bad.
All right.
Was that your first time playing this?
First time in a while.
All right. Okay. When is the next panel? Are they starting at 3:00?
I have no clue.
I think so.
3:30? I don't even know what the next panel is.
It's the trivia question block.
Oh, that would be, is that up here?
I think so, yeah.
I thought it was downstairs, because like the Woodmen were lined up in the back, and...
Yeah, I saw them leave.
Oh, I have a claim to fame. I was on the team that beat the Woodmen 2 weeks in a row, the last two weeks.
Oh, I heard about that.
Wait.
So,
I'm going to drop the mic, but probably kill you guys.
No. Not our mics.
I always want to drop a mic, maybe some other time.
The Woodmen are basically very well known for the question block trivia that they have, I think, monthly.
Monthly at the Wild Rover in Kirkland.
Yeah, and they always win.
Almost always.
Except those 2 weeks.
Yeah, those 2 weeks were crazy, and we beat them by 8 points, the first 8 or 6 points the first week, but then it was 11 points, or 1 week. 2 months ago, we beat them by about 6 or 7, but we beat them by 11 or something last month, and they just
raged. When they did the trivia block last year here at SRGE,
yeah.
Actually, me and my two buddies, we decided we wanted to give it a shot. We wound up tying for third.
Yeah,
that's nice.
Yeah, tying for third, and of course, Woodmen won. You know, go for it. I don't think it was by very much.
Yeah, I wasn't around for that, unfortunately. So
second and third were much better.
So if you guys are ever interested in that, that's just a quick plug. Nathan, who's one of our founders of SRGE, by all means, hit up Video Games Northwest. That's where he blogs about it. But the trivia is hosted monthly out of the Wild Rover in Kirkland. The grand finale is held at SRGE every year. So if you have a lot of points, then you basically get an invite for this. You sign up. You can still win. You can still freely enter.
They do a league.
But whoever has the most points at the end of this, tonight's thing, they win all of 2015, and I don't know what we do. More beer. Because there's a lot of free beer coming out. Yeah, there's free beer coming out. So, and prizes.
Everybody over 21 in here?
Yeah, that is the one catch about the Wild Rover.
Anyone under 21?
There you go.
Okay, yay booze! All right.
stick around, check that out. Nathan's gonna be doing awesome.
It's a lot of fun. You get a lot of audio questions too, which I thought was.
Nate has an amazing production value on his trivia.
Audio, audio questions, video questions as well. I know last year he said, name the game for this particular commercial.
Oh yeah, no, it's geared. If you think you're good at trivia at video games, you know everything about video games. I promise you, Nate will find something that will wreck you. I'm not joking. Yeah. We will break your spirit and find the most obscure crap about video game history and challenge you. But it's a lot of fun. I promise you, you'll love it. I didn't do it for a long time just because it's not my thing. And then last two months, friends invited me out and was like, hey, you should get on this. And plus, you're a Nintendo guy, you should know a thing or two. And so it was fun. I don't know what I'm gonna do if I don't win though. the next time we play. All right, so that wraps us up, though.
Any final questions from you guys in the audience about the games or any of the other competitions or possible world records? What's up?
What got you into just trying to set world records in general? What
got me into playing these?
Yeah, why?
Ain't just go for records, period.
I've always been a huge fan of The Wizard. Ever since I watched the movie and ever since I was, 5, 6 years old when I first picked up the NES, 5 years old, I got my first NES and I was never off of it. And I wanted to be in events such as video Armageddon like they did in The Wizard. And all of a sudden, I just started.
That's what it was called.
So, I wanted to, and then I just started seeing that they were doing local competitions. I didn't know about. I didn't do my first local competition until SRGE 2013. My very first arcade.
Not the drink that's sold on Amazon. Us. You call it SRGE. I make fun of people who do that because there are lots of people who do it, and I'm just like, how did that happen?
Yeah.
How did it start?
But this was really my my first big gaming competition that involved multiple games, and I just kind of got hooked. I enjoyed it. I wound up getting these because I know how valuable these are, and well. Hey, this store had reproduction carts of these, so once I found that out, I grabbed my money and I went to the store and I got both of them at the same time. So,
if I had any advice for anybody who's not really into these or kind of want to make something out of them, I mean, if you can get a hold of carts, they're awesome. You know, like I said, retrousb.com. And but if you get play them at a party. Have a bunch of people over and go, hey, let's see who can get the top score.
Yeah,
and when you do that, it becomes
great,
a lot of fun.
Great party games.
Yeah, and you start to break it down. You start talking about it, you know, and you're like, oh, yeah, you sucked at Pilot Wings, but I was awesome as it, you know. So, you know, it's a lot of fun. I do it a lot for retro parties, and,
I've had some of my friends, you know, kind of gather around, and we just all just play.
Yeah.
Just have a good time with it.
Come visit the stream booth. Come down to the retrocast booth, and we'll play something, and we'll show you the wonders. All right, well, guys, this is Paul Tesi.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much for coming to this panel. Thank you for bearing with me, and I hope that all the tips and advice that I've given for these games will even help you achieve your better scores. So,
all right, guys.
Thanks a lot, guys. Thanks. I appreciate this. And have a great time at Seattle Retro.
I got it.